Welcome to Pharmacology Insights, where we break down complex pharmacology into simple, easy-to-understand concepts. Antipsychotics have changed the treatment of serious mental illnesses like schizophrenia. But they also come with side effects, and one of the most troubling is extrapyramidal symptoms, or EPS. So what exactly are EPS? Why do they happen? And what can be done about them? Let's break it down. The term extrapyramidal refers to brain regions that control movement outside the main motor pathway known as the pyramidal tract. These include the basal ganglia, highlighted in red in the diagram, substantia nigra, and striatum, all of which help regulate posture, muscle tone, and smooth voluntary movement. When this system is disrupted, movements become disordered. That's what leads to extrapyramidal symptoms. These include dystonia, which is sudden, often painful muscle contractions that can cause twisting or abnormal postures. It can happen in the neck, jaw, eyes, or even the whole body. There might be akathisia, a strong sense of inner restlessness. Patients might feel like they just can't sit still, constantly shifting, pacing, or fidgeting. There could also be symptoms that mimic Parkinson's disease, like muscle rigidity, tremors, and slowed movement. And over time, there's tardive dyskinesia, which are repetitive, involuntary movements, usually of the face, tongue, or limbs. These can appear after long-term antipsychotic use and may be difficult to reverse. Most antipsychotics work mainly by blocking dopamine D2 receptors, especially in the mesolimbic pathway, which is thought to be overactive in conditions like schizophrenia. This helps reduce psychotic symptoms like hallucinations and delusions. But here's the catch. Dopamine doesn't just affect mood and perception. It is also critical for movement. One key player in motor control is the nigrostriatal pathway, which links the substantia nigra to the striatum, regions in the brain that help fine-tune and coordinate movement. Here's where the mechanism gets interesting. Dopamine plays a key role in keeping our movements smooth and coordinated. It does this by balancing two opposing circuits in the basal ganglia, the direct pathway, which promotes movement, and the indirect pathway, which inhibits movement. To strike that balance, dopamine stimulates the direct pathway through D1 receptors, and at the same time, suppresses the indirect pathway through D2 receptors. The result? A fine-tuned system that allows for fluid, controlled movement. But when antipsychotics, especially typical antipsychotics, block D2 receptors in the nigrostriatal pathway, this balance shifts. The indirect pathway becomes overactive, putting the brakes on movement. That's what leads to extrapyramidal symptoms. This mechanism mirrors what happens in Parkinson's disease, where dopamine neurons in the substantia nigra degenerate. That's why EPS is described as drug-induced Parkinsonism. Not all antipsychotics carry the same risk for extrapyramidal symptoms. Typical antipsychotics, such as haloperidol and chlorpromazine, have strong D2 receptor blocking activity, making them effective, but also more likely to cause EPS. Atypical, or second-generation antipsychotics, like risperidone, olanzapine, or quetiapine, have weaker D2 receptor binding and also block serotonin 5-HT2A receptors. This helps balance dopamine activity, especially in the nigrostriatal pathway, thus reducing the risk of movement side effects. Extrapyramidal symptoms don't all show up at once, their timing depends on the type. Dystonia and akathisia can develop quickly, sometimes within just a few hours to a few days after starting treatment. Parkinsonism tends to appear a bit later, usually after several days or even weeks. And then there's tardive dyskinesia, which often emerges after months or years of ongoing use. This one's especially concerning because it can be long-lasting, and in some cases, irreversible. Certain factors can increase the risk of developing extrapyramidal symptoms. These include higher doses of antipsychotics, use of typical or first-generation agents, older age, being female, and having a previous history of EPS. When it comes to treating extrapyramidal symptoms, the evidence for effective medications is limited. The most reliable options are to lower the dose, stop the drug if possible, or switch to a second-generation antipsychotic with a lower risk of EPS. But the most effective strategy is prevention. That means using the lowest effective dose, monitoring patients regularly, and carefully selecting the right antipsychotic based on individual risk factors, all of which can go a long way in reducing the chances of EPS. To recap, antipsychotics block dopamine. When this blockade affects the brain's motor circuits, especially the nigrostriatal pathway, movement control is disrupted. The result? Extrapyramidal symptoms. Understanding this mechanism not only helps clinicians minimize side effects, but also leads to safer, more personalized treatments for people who need these powerful medications. And that's it for today's pharmacology video. If you enjoyed this video, please give it a thumbs up and subscribe to the channel for more pharmacology content.